All right, without further ado, we'd like to get started today. And we talked a lot about yesterday about innovation, but innovation doesn't always just occur with technology and on the golf course. It also occurs in leadership. And so we've asked three leaders from our host golf federations to come up today and talk a little bit about that. And without further ado, here is John Bodenhamer of the USGA, Roland Deveau of Golf Canada, and Federico Valdez of the Mexican Golf Federation. Welcome, gents.
That's good.
Just make yourself comfortable.
Should I come here?
Sure.
Sure.
Get the furthest away? Okay, and I'll come over here and sit down with you guys too. Make you feel cozy. There we go. I'll leave one seat just in case you guys start getting mad at me. As I mentioned, innovation occurs in leadership and in governance, and that's what we want to talk about. You three are very well versed in all this. And Federico, why don't we start with Mexico and talk a little bit about some of the changes that have occurred there over the last couple of years, really as a result of some of the international competitions and things that have gone on. And just give us a rundown of what it's like in Mexico now for international competition.
Well, thank you. Good morning, everyone. It seems like, not seems like it, it's, Mexico has been in the news and in the good sense of the world, golf news, in, thanks to the WGC that has been played last week in Mexico City, including the Gol Chapultepec. And I would say for starters that that's kind of the, it represents in the whole sense of the word in many ways what's the situation here in Mexico in golf sense and golf wise. We have been hosting international competitions in the last couple of years. We've hosted PGA Tour events the last 10 years in Mayakoba Golf Classic and the OHL Classic at Mayakoba later in the last 5 years. And we hosted the Central and Caribbean Games in 2014, where golf actually participated again after many years of not being part of the competition. Only last year, 2016, we hosted the Junior America's Cup, and we hosted the World Amateur Team Championships. So the World Amateur Team Championships also, it was kind of the pinnacle of our efforts in promoting golf in Mexico as a country and hosting the world of golf internationally in our country. The site for this world amateur was Cancun Riviera Maya. Especially in Riviera Maya, we played two beautiful golf courses, the Mayakoba and El Camaleon and Iberostar. And for personally, the World Amateur Team Championship was a life project. I've been working for the World Amateur, well, I've been working for the Mexican Golf Federation for the last 8 years. And the last six, I've been focusing mostly in the World Amateur Team Championship as part of my work and responsibility. So after many years of hard work and basically, I mean, we did it because we love the game so much and we actually wanted to give back at least a little bit of what we have been receiving from the golf community all around the world. And we tried to, 50 years after the first time we hosted the event, we tried to show the golf community, especially the amateur golfers and world golf federations that that we have something to offer and it's high quality and the country, regardless of the bad publicity that we have receiving for the last few years regarding security and stuff, we showed quite some people about the possibilities of actually coming to Mexico and playing golf in Mexico with very high quality golf courses and what I think was a first class event. So, so that's pretty much what the Mexican Golf Federation has been working in the last few years.
How does it now play out? You're obviously it leads into bigger things such as the Olympics. Has that been a big part of your focus?
Sure. The Olympics for golf and for Mexico has represented in many ways mostly mainly good things, specifically federal funding from the government. the Mexican government has very, very specific policy regarding supporting sports that actually have participation in the Olympics. And since golf was included in this Olympic program since, I think it was 2009 when it was announced, and we started working with the federal government and the National Olympic Committee, our Mexican Olympic Committee, towards Rio and towards golf going back to the Olympics. For us, it's not only about the Olympics, fortunately. We started in 2014 with the Nanjing Youth Olympic Games. Then we hosted, as I was telling you, in Veracruz, the Central and Caribbean Games. Then we came to, we participated in Toronto in the Pan American Games. And then by the time that we actually arrived to Rio, we had done our homework and actually learned a lot from these new relationships between the Mexican Golf Federation, the government, the Olympic Committee, the Ministry of Sports, that we were actually first timers in all of the sense of the word, trying to get ready for such an important event as the Olympic Games are. So we participated in the Olympics with three athletes. Two ladies and one player, one man, and they did well. Some say they could have done better.
they always say do that. Better, Federico. Always do better.
Yeah, they can always do better. But we're very pleased. Actually, having three players represent Mexico in the Olympics was a huge success for us.
Since that time now, what's gone into in terms of player development in Mexico? Where do you see that going?
Well. But here is the Mexican team for the World Amateur Team Championship. From the left is Maria Fassi, then Ana Paula Valdez, Isabella Fierro, then Marcela Coglan, which was a coach for the team, and Dolores, which was she was until recently the president of the Women's Mexican Golf Association. We have very high hopes on our players. We are working very hard in growing the program. Raising funds for the Mexican team isn't easy. So we're trying to innovate. Actually, we're rebranding our national teams under a private initiative to actually make it easier for us to raise funds. The federal government has changed its policy regarding supporting national teams in every sport. So we are trying to accommodate them with a solution that best represents the interest of the federal government in supporting private initiatives for players like these three girls. In the near future, we are hoping that we should be able to offer Mexican golf the best possible players, amateur and professional, to represent Mexico in all of the competitions that we can participate. And just in particular from this picture, I can showcase Isabella Fierro, the smaller one. She won the Women's Mexican Amateur and the South American Amateur in almost consecutive weeks. So she's playing really hard and she's 15. So we have very high hopes for her. She will eventually go to college as we have many players going to. And in the men's side, we are hoping that some of our players will actually recover their PGA status as they had a couple of years ago. So another example, for example, Roberto Diaz, who played the WGC last week, he won a gold medal in the Central and Caribbean Games in 2014. So we're getting there. I mean, we'll eventually have enough money. There's never enough money, I know. But we will eventually have more money to offer these players the possibility of actually competing against the best and continue to compete against the best. And hopefully we will have a much better results from them and them actually becoming better persons and better players.
Great, thank you, Federico. Roland, let's move on to Golf Canada. And Golf Canada has, I think many people may know the top line story, but they don't really know what goes on behind. That you've really transitioned from being just a golf association to being an NSO, a national sports organization. And I guess maybe the first thing is, you know, how has the role changed? Can you kind of define and tell us what that means?
Well, you know, we have a long storied history back to 1895, but we knew how to run tournaments, great tournaments. We knew how to do rules and handicapping and course rating. But in 2005, we were designated by the federal government as the national sport organization. And as a result of that, you know, even though we have a lot of partners in the in the industry, in the golf industry, and the sport, 2005 opened up a brand new world for us. And you can see on the screen, you know, what that means. I mean, essentially, as a national sport organization, you're designated as the body that's going to administer the sport in the country. So it's up to you to lead and collaborate with all the partners in the sport to push the principles that that you as a sport organization is responsible for and responsible to government for. There is funding, but there's also a lot of accountability. So combined with that, you'll see in the top right-hand corner there, obviously, if you go back just one slide, as Federico mentioned, it also comes with being in the Olympics, which is a great privilege, but it's also a great responsibility. And at the bottom left, one of our other partners in terms of our role in the sport is on the podium. And when you're in Canada, they take their Olympics pretty seriously here. And when you're a sport organization, you're not expected to do your best at the Olympics. You're expected to come back with a medal. So that group in terms of on the podium is you're totally accountable to go to the Olympics and win a medal. Now, having said that, you know, obviously two of the most important objectives of a sport organization is participation and excellence. And Olympics, obviously, it's a great event, but and it is about the medals. But what we found as a sport organization was that it really it had great benefits in terms of participation in two ways. First, Olympics create heroes, and we saw that last year with our two men and two ladies that represented us in Rio. They were national heroes, and those types of heroes drive participation at the grassroots, and that's really important. And the other way it drives participation is when you've got the Olympics, on the worldwide stage, you introduce the sport to people who've never, particularly golf, who had been, had been out of the Olympics for over 100 years, and Canada, incidentally, was the defending champion.
Had a long run.
Had a long run. but you know, it just opens up the world to people who've never seen golf. So that was just another benefit of driving that. So as a result of that, if you go to the next slide, you'll see the. What we had to do as a national sport organization was to go back to fundamentals and develop a strategic plan based on our role, we had to do that using basically the four principles, and we call it our house, Golf Canada House here, and you'll see there are four pillars. And the pillars are related specifically to our role as a national sport organization with Sport Canada, and they are growing participation in the game, ensuring excellence in terms of our elite players and officials, expanding capacity, again, ensuring that we can service the sport, that there's sustainable funding and fiscal responsibility in the sport, and finally, to foster interaction. And of course, you know, we've got a lot of partners. We've got over 60 associations that we deal with in terms of administering the sport. So, you know, that interaction is there. So, again, you know, In our previous role, we were basically, you know, we were an association that ran tournaments. But now it's a much deeper responsibility, and one we're very proud of is Golf in Schools and Future Links, which is our long, involves our long-term player development program. Golf at Schools has each year 370,000 kids that we introduce to the game in over 3,100 schools across Canada. So we're really proud of it, and it's all based on, again, the sport development aspect of it. Player development was in Troon last year, and just happened to a gentleman from the Chinese Golf Association that came up to me and said, you know, we took some of your player development program on the website that you had there. So it's a scary proposition. We've got 1.3 billion people now who are using part of our player development program. So that's pretty cool.
I hope we got some royalties. Did you want to talk about the provincial partners here we've got?
So another aspect in terms of when we talk about governance and innovation in governance is we've got, obviously, we're a national sport organization, and we do have, obviously, as I mentioned, a lot of partners in the industry. But in terms of the provinces, there are 10 provinces, and we have to deal with, you know, we're responsible for the sport, but a lot of the program delivery is actually done at the provinces. So one of the things we've worked on, and something, and that includes whether it's championships or player development, but what we've done, you know, just this past year, in terms of innovation, is we said, you know, how can we better deliver programs and services? So we've actually gone first principles first in terms of governance. What is the strategic plan? We've taken the common elements of what our strategic plans are and put them, you know, we've agreed to what they are, and now we're going to focus on delivery and determining what are the appropriate roles and responsibilities for the national bodies and the provincial bodies. So that's something that's actually quite new, and we're quite proud of it. Now, you know, finally, in terms of innovation and governance, an important element of our responsibility as a national sport organization is golfers with disabilities. It's something that's really gaining a foothold and something that we take very seriously at Golf Canada. You know, we've had some individuals in the past. This was actually Brian McLeod from my home province in Nova Scotia, twice runner-up in the World Blind Golf Championships. He captured 67 of 100 of the tournaments he played nationally and internationally. But these people are passionate about golf, no less than we are. And I know John's going to talk more about it, but it's very important that we make our sport accessible to them because they really enjoy the sport. If you go to the next slide, an important initiative that we've just announced implemented is a relationship with the Special Olympics. Special Olympics Canada, we are actually, this year we'll be, they will be participating in some competitions at our courses that we are holding championships at. And actually golf is the very first sport in Canada that's developed a training manual for coaches in terms of the Special Olympics. So we're proud of that, and it's sort of the, you know, the cutting edge of what's going on in innovation.
Perfect. Thank you, Roland. Moving on to talk about a little bit more about golfers with disabilities, John, I know this is an important part of the USGA's look forward as well.
It is, Bob. Before I move to that, I would like to just say something that just kind of dawns on me sitting up here with Roland and Federico and seeing all that's happening these couple of days. It is quite symbolic that our three organizations are together to stage this symposium. And you know, you think about societal changes that are impacting all of us. Globalization's bringing us closer together. Technology's putting information at our fingertips like never before. More and more women throughout golf are empowered to make financial decisions. I mean, there's more and more and more, but what has become apparent to all of us within the USGA that borders don't really mean a whole lot in the game of golf. And I think working together with our friends in Mexico and Canada is critically important to us at the USGA, because we think we can make great strides together throughout the continent. And so we think it's important to be here. And this is just one. As Roland mentioned, let me just say a few things. You know, I saw when we opened the conference yesterday, that opening video, I wrote down a couple of things. It said, in referring to innovation, challenging the norms and asking what can be. And it reminded me of one of my favorite quotes that I keep very close in my office and have for many years. And it was something Robert F. Kennedy said many years ago that I've taken great inspiration from regarding innovation. He said, there are those that look at things the way that they are and ask why. I dream of things that never were and ask why not. I think that's so powerful, and I think it speaks to much of what we're trying to do in the game and in society. And at the USGA, these days, we're asking a lot of ourselves, and why not? And this first slide speaks to one of those things, how we're innovating with regard to golfers with disabilities. And if you go to the next slide, I'd like to share a little bit more of that thinking with you. That previous slide was Dennis Walters, by the way, if some of you might have recognized him. He's a really wonderful individual that puts on an amazing exhibition, if you have a chance to see him, as a golfer with disabilities. In looking at this community in America, in the United States of America, it is really quite amazing. In our desire to be inclusive and innovate, we looked at 60 million Americans with a disability of one sort or another, and 10% of those are estimated to play golf. 6 million of those play golf. It's quite remarkable. And that number is growing pretty quickly. So at our annual meeting a few weeks ago, we put our stake in the ground. We made a commitment to really embrace this community in a strong way. And by 2020, we are committed, if not sooner, to create a new national championship, USGA National Championship for golfers with disabilities, for men and women of every age, of every background, amateurs, and perhaps even professionals. And we are excited about it. And what is our objective? Our single objective is to inspire the game and this community. USGA Championships, we think, have done that over the years, whether you look at our Public Links Championship when it started in the 20s and how the public game grew, our Junior Championships, and even the Senior Open, how it inspired the senior game in our country. And now next year we'll start our new U.S. Senior Women's Open, which we hope will greatly inspire the women's game. But our objectives are simply to inspire and encourage this community to participate in growing the game, to compete and give them a competitive opportunities, and to provide an on-ramp and avenues to the finest golfers within this community to compete, hopefully by 2024, in golf in the Paralympics. That's a intentional goal of ours. We are an advocate of golf being included in the Paralympics, and we hope that happens in 2024, and this is one step along that route. We also have a governance responsibility that we think is very important. Back in the mid-1990s, the USGA drafted what are the modified rules of golf for golfers with disabilities. And our recent announcement about the rules modernization of the playing rules, it's not our only modernization project. You'll see that a couple of other examples in a minute, but we are modernizing those modified rules, and I'll share with you why. Right now, those modified rules have five categories. Golfers that are amputees, blind, or use wheelchairs or canes and crutches, or have an intellectual disability. We're gonna modernize that. We're gonna think about what that should look like as we go forward. We're going to think about what equipment might need to look like and how the rules should cover that for golfers with disabilities in our governance role. And we're going to create categories that will ladder up into the Paralympics, working with the International Golf Federation to do that. You know, it's funny, this really got on our radar screen last year, last spring, when we had an individual contact us through the Florida State Golf Association. He was a golfer who happened to be blind, and he was wanting to qualify for the US Open. And actually later that summer, he came back and said, I want to qualify for the US Amateur. Will the Florida State Golf Association adopt the modified rules for golfers with disabilities for US Open qualifying? And so we discussed that, and they are a set of rules that need to be adopted by the committee in charge of the competition. We talked about it, and we made it very clear, both internally and externally, that we were going to be inclusive, and yes, by all means, the Florida State Golf Association and any other entity should adopt those rules to be inclusive of those individuals, and if he would have qualified for the U.S. Open, we'd have adopted them at the U.S. Open or the U.S. Amateur as well. And that's what's coming. Embracing this community, we think, is critically important. And I think also, from an innovation standpoint, educating the industry about what this can mean for the game, for the business of golf, for embracing this community, and we think it's great for all of the above. But there is going to take some education. What are the agronomic considerations on a golf course with wheelchairs and canes and crutches? There are some misperceptions, and I think the USGA and all of us together in North America can play a role in clarifying some of those. It's not the only thing that we're innovating as it pertains to governance. If you can go to the next slide. Imagine a world handicap system. To governance, when we say governance at the USGA and with our partners at the RNA, we talk about the playing rules, the rules of amateur status, the equipment rules, and the rules of handicapping. And we are in the process of herding the cats with this one. This is a world handicap system that the USGA and the RNA are leading, but five other handicap authorities around the world, among other countries. We began discussions with the RNA to begin leading this and resourcing it in 2012. It is about to come to fruition. We're not at the end of that journey, but we're very close. And simply our objectives are to create one algorithm, one handicap system worldwide. So whether you're playing in LA or London or Boston or Beijing or Tokyo or Toronto, you're playing under handicap that was computed the same way, under the same course ratings, and playing equitably with anybody, anywhere, at any time. And we think that's a noble thing. It's not a different than what we, unlike what we did with the rules of golf, partnering with the RNA in 1952 for one set of rules, or in 2012 with one set of rules of amateur status, and we're excited about it. And so just finally, a couple of pieces. The next slide, please. There's a world handicap research team that crunches all the numbers with developing this algorithm, looking at course rating. It is a worldwide body of folks from around the globe that are a lot smarter than me, and statisticians and mathematicians. And one of the innovations they've come up with, a world handicap system will be based on the USGA handicap system predominantly, an average-based system where most all scores are posted, what we use throughout North America. But other parts of the world, it's much different. It's an incremental system that are based largely on competition scores. But we're combining, taking as a basis, the USGA course and slope rating system. Slope is used around most of the world. And we're going to take the best of all the other systems to come up with a world handicap system. This is one example. A daily playing adjustment. We don't have that here in North America, but what it is if you're out at your golf course, just down the road here at Shaughnessy Golf and Country Club in Vancouver, they don't get a lot of wind, but if there's a 40-mile-an-hour windy day or some other weather condition, or they've just had the Canadian Open and the rough is at 6 or 8 inches, those differences will affect the course rating, and now as golfers play that day and they shoot higher scores than they normally would, this system will now make an automatic adjustment at the end of the day to reflect that, and golfers' handicaps for that day will be adjusted. It'll automatically happen within the system. Technology will allow us to do that. And imagine with 50 million scores posted on GIN this year, just in the United States, if we combine 16 million golfers, help grow that number, and then capture and use that data from those golfers, what power, what benefit that could be for our game on a lot of fronts. So all of that technology, all of that cooperation, collaboration, the herding of cats, we're almost at the end of that journey, and this is one innovation among many. So we're excited about it. We think it's good for the game and look forward to more cooperation.
Look at you guys, right on time. You must be in the governance and the looking at rules and things and everything. You're just right down to the last second. We will transition now. I'll ask Roland and Federico to leave the stage, and if we do that, we can give a round of applause. That'd be great for their efforts here today.